thank you everyone for joining today, taking time out of this busy holiday season and work schedule and everything that we have going on. I know there's tons of things that are trying to pull at your time. I think we've got a good power-packed bunch of information to hand out today. Matt and I have been traveling around a lot of our region. I work out of the southeast and delivering these in person, and a lot of people can't make it to the in-person events. Either it's too far to drive or too much going on work-wise and what have you. So we're really happy to be able to offer this condensed version online today. if you have any questions, again, let me reiterate, we've got some of our fellow evangelists are standing by in the chat to be able to answer your questions, and please feel free to pop those in. So we're going to be covering some Windows Server 2012 R2 and System Center R2 information today. A little bit about just the schedule for today, and hopefully you're able to see the slides. We're going to do an introduction to the course with Matt Hester. That'll be from around the next 15 minutes, and then I'm going to take it away with introduction to Hyper-V. There's going to be some demo there for the server manager as well, because you need to understand both components in Server 2012 R2 in order to effectively manage a Hyper-V server. Then we're going to get into how to do host configuration in Hyper-V, and we'll be covering everything from the basics to some of the more advanced settings. After that, we're going to take a break. We're going to come back and talk about virtual machine configuration, and that'll be with Matt Hester. And then he's going to jump into clustering and resiliency right after that. I'll be coming back with virtual machine mobility. That's live migration for you VMware admins. That's the same thing as a vMotion or storage vMotion, and there's we'll talk through some of the differences there as well. Then we're going to take a small break. We're going to run the backup and replication with Hyper-V. That'll be a demo walking us through how to add the backup component and then how to turn on replication in Hyper-V. And then wrapping it up, Matt will come back with managing Hyper-V with Virtual Machine Manager, and then we'll have show some additional resources and such. All right, a little bit about me. Skip too many slides there. A little bit about me. I'm about 17 years in the industry. I was in the Navy prior to being in the IT community, and worked on, I had a Commodore 64 growing up as a kid, and then I jumped into in life that were more fun, and maybe, you know, Atari, Nintendo, not really computing, but had some fun there. But when I was in the Navy near the end of it, if anybody remembers, the IBM Aptiva started hitting Walmarts and became an affordable way of buying the newest, latest, and greatest. And I decided I was going to jump back into computers again. So went that route. And as soon as I got out, I went into Microsoft classes. I was supposed to be going through Novell classes, and the people at my local New Horizons said, well, you might want to look at this Microsoft thing, because Active Directory and all the things that are going on there may be a safer bet. So I was really, really happy that they steered me the way they have. I since then have moved through different positions into consulting the last number of years. And doing some consulting mainly around VMware, some Citrix, but not a lot of Hyper-V. And that's what's very interesting about how I came to work at Microsoft. For many years, I was very deep into the VMware side of things, and loved it. When I started looking into Hyper-V, it was because a couple of my customers were telling me, you need to look at the new Hyper-V V3. And so I started looking into Hyper-V 3, was what they were calling it at the time, and there wasn't a lot out there. But what intrigued me the most was the SMB3 protocol, the ability to run virtual machines on a network. Because I was a big VMware on NetApp or NFS fan, because of that ability to segregate virtual machines into different folders, and snapshotting was easier, restoring was much easier, and so I was a real big fan of that technology. And I saw what 2012 was going to be coming out with. I got very excited, decided to apply for the position at Microsoft, and I think it's been the best decision in a long time. I really love it here. Since then, I've also started a blog, virtuallycloudman.com. You'll a good bit of the resource from today there, and I also have a blog on TechNet that you can see here with the link. A couple of other links here, my Twitter account, so at Tommy underscore Wilson, to follow me there. Join up with me on LinkedIn. I also do office hours every Monday from 4 to 5 o'clock. That's at aka.ms/TPO hours. You can sign up there for a slot and we can talk through anything you're doing. Maybe it's a hands-on lab component, stuff like that. You know, we try not to do support calls that way, but if you want to talk through something you're doing in the trial or whatnot with Windows Azure, Server 2012, System Center, or Hyper-V, please give that a shot. Also, if you want, if you're in the Southeast, you might want to join my meetup. That's a Southeast IT Professionals meetup, and we have all kinds of different events that we run. And then you can also email me at tommy.patterson@microsoft.com. And Matt, let's hear a little bit from you.
Good afternoon or good evening. My name is Matt Hester, and like Tommy, I'm also an IT Pro Evangelist from Microsoft. I've been here a little bit longer than Tommy. I've been here for about 13 years, and our career was very similar, but I started out as a certified trainer way back in the NT351 days. So I've been around technology for quite some time, and yes, you're seeing the fact that I'm in mourning right now. I'm an Ohio State fan, but I've written a couple books on our technology as well, so feel free to check any of that out. You can always get a hold of me in one of three ways. You can email me at mhester@microsoft.com. You can follow me on Twitter at Matthew Hester. That second link, the aka.ms/MattHester, is my blog. And like Tommy, we do a lot of things on our blogs together. We do a lot of blogging on technologies. And we just finished a couple months ago a huge series on VMware or Microsoft. And that was kind of what spun this IT camp into kind of the forefront of the types of things that we can do. We get asked a lot of questions because, like Tommy, I'm also a VCP professional. I'm certified on that, but I can't fool you all. I don't use the technology every day like you all listening to me today. But why did I do that? And why has this course existed? Well, let's talk about that. And oh, by the way, if you want to say all kinds of fantastic things about me, please feel free to email my manager, Chris Koenig. If you have anything negative to say, please email me first at mhester@microsoft.com. I'll make sure I'll get it into the proper complaint template, and then I promise I'll forward it on to Chris for you. So with that, so why are we here? What is this course for? This course is designed for everybody that's relatively new to Hyper-V, but it's also specifically been written to help translate this, because one thing I want to be very clear that Tommy and I are going to tell you where we have a great technology, because we firmly believe with Windows Server 2012 and 2012 R2, from a technical perspective, Hyper-V has caught up, and it is a great product, and it's caught up to VMware. Not to say that VMware is a bad product, it's a great product. It has a lot of great technologies, but what I think had happened is a lot of people have forgotten about Hyper-V, because when we first entered the market, we didn't have a lot of the common features like Ocean, for example, or some of the things that we talked about, NFS, and that's how he liked it. Well, Hyper-V has come a long way, folks. So this course today is going to be designed to be a translation course and an introduction course to help you understand where we have our technologies, because when people say I need to compare Hyper-V to VMware, depending on how you look at that, your stack can get very, very different to how it's set up. So when we take a look at this class today, you're going to see a lot of it is going to be around that basic transition of working with those technologies, working with the ability to handle how that works. You knew what it was called in VMware, now we're going to know it's something called in Hyper-V. So it's not to bash one technology or another, it's kind of take this approach of, hey, they do it this way. And there's a lot of really interesting things where we just approach the technology very differently, especially around networking, which is something we'll talk about today. We accomplished at the end of the day, we both do the same thing, both VMware and us, but how we get there is very, very different. So that's why we put this course together, to make sure that we can help you understand where we're at from a technology perspective and how far Hyper-V has come along, really, in just the last 5 years that we have today. So you're going to get an intro to this, and as Tommy mentioned, condensed, we normally do this as an all-day-long IT camp. You're getting this in about 3 hours, or 3.5 hours, I should say. So let's understand let's just set the table here. So key technologies. It all starts with our hypervisor, Hyper-V versus hypervisor. And that's where we begin, and that's where you'll see some of the intro demos that Tommy's going to do in a minute. But that's the beginning of it all. That's our basics of technology. That's where we start all the virtualization stuff that we have. But then we also talk about Virtual Machine Manager versus vCenter. Because one thing that commonly happens with customers like yourselves, you're not just running hypervisor. You're not just running the vSphere hypervisor. You're running vSphere plus vCenter, usually at a standard level or up to an enterprise, depending on what your company is. The thing I want to be very clear to you on is that if anybody ever says, Matt, let's talk about VMware versus Microsoft, the very first question I'm going to ask you, are you going to bring vCenter into the conversation? Because the minute you tell me you're bringing in vCenter, that means I get to say System Center, which means I also get to bring in Virtual Machine Manager. So whenever you look at the comparison papers that are out there on the net, and there are a ton of them, and this is why we did the blog series that we did, that try to compare vCenter plus vSphere Hypervisor to just Hyper-V. That's not necessarily a fair comparison not a fair comparison in my eyes. So whenever you say vCenter, I get to say System Center. That's the crux of this. And when you look up our stacks, we have a thing called App Controller, which helps self-service provisioning. There's a thing called vCloud Director, does the same kind of thing. We have Ops Manager, System Center Ops Manager, and they have vCops for that management. What I find is interesting with a lot of the customers that Tommy and I have run into, they're actually using System Center Operations Manager to not only manage their Microsoft environments, but also to manage their virtualization, their VMware environments. And they might have a third-party admin pack to help that there. We have Data Protection Manager. They have vSphere Data Protection. We have Service Manager. They have vCloud Automation Center. And they have Orchestrator, and we have Orchestrator. And what's funny about automation, folks, that we call it pretty much the same name, but most of you are using PowerShell. So at the end of the day, it really is kind of how do you automate your data centers. PowerShell is a viable alternative, and Orchestrator is also a very viable alternative. What you're looking at here is when you look at the stack is that we have the same things that they have. We're up the stack that's here, but we put it all under the brand of System Center R2. So whenever anybody says vCenter to me, I get to say System Center. Now, what's important about this is that System Center not only manages our virtualization environment, System Center knows how to talk to the cloud. It also knows how to talk to physical servers. So we don't limit to what it can manage. It treats every server pretty much the same. It doesn't really matter what we have. And more importantly, when you look at this from a cost perspective, we are less expensive than VMware by far. And in most cases, depending on what level you go up the stack, we can save you five times of what you're spending on VMware. Now, with that said, once again, what was the purpose of the course? Not to talk about those kind of things, tell you where we are from a technology standpoint. But at the end of the day, folks, how many of your budgets are actually increasing? Are they actually increasing? So we really want to make sure that you understand these types of things, that when you're looking at your next virtualization project, that you put Hyper-V into the mix. It's not enough for Tommy and I to spend the next 3 hours with you to talk about these different technologies. But it's enough for us to kind of get you started so that when you're looking at that next project that comes across your desk, people are virtualizing more and more every day, you want to take a look at Microsoft. That project's going to probably save you money compared to a VMware alternative. But that's something you need to vet out for yourselves, especially when you see some of the products that we have. Now, one of the key things that we have, and we'll see this slide again today, is that it's not a clean comparison. I can't really just compare Hyper-V to vSphere Hypervisor. Because there's things that we do just in the core Hyper-V versus things that we do on a core Windows server that is covered by some of the components inside of vCenter. So when we get into some of those other complex topics, we might switch between the tools that you'll use to build a cluster or things that are built into Windows that help Hyper-V out that are all free tools versus some of the stuff that we might have to do in System Center Virtual Machine Manager. Things like doing application level integration, load balancing VMs, creating clouds, being able to manage multiple vSphere's. So when you see these types of things, understand that it's not a clean comparison. That when people say vCenter, there's going to be components that I can do with the built-in Microsoft Windows tools that are a part of vCenter, and there's going to be some things that I need VMM to get some of those same components. So this slide is just kind of illustrate a lot of those things, and you notice that down the left-hand side it says no for a bunch of things for the Windows management tool set. Remember, that's the free stuff, and when you look at some of those topics like manage local network switches, Hyper-V network virtualization, those aren't things that are built into our core OS, but that's why we have Virtual Machine Manager. So we see that crossover, those types of things that we can do. So with that, we're kind of in the introduction. I'm going to turn it over to Tommy now for a little bit, and he's going to take you through the host configuration and kind of get started on what does it mean to actually be using Hyper-V. So Tommy, I'll go ahead and turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Matt. So a couple of things here, folks. I hear a lot of questions at my events that say, is Virtual Machine Manager the equivalent of vCenter? You will see in this particular deck or show today, you'll see it where we say that in the slides. But personally, knowing how things work and seeing it in action, it's not really an apples to apples. All right, Hyper-V Manager that's free in Hyper-V, very similar to what you can do in Virtual Center. But then there are some things that Virtual Center does past what Hyper-V Manager does. Then you have Virtual Machine Manager, and it does things that aren't really necessarily inside vCenter. So there's some differences there. I just don't want to get hung up too much on the apples-to-apples comparison today. We're just going to say these particular features may apply to that type of technology. So as we jump into the beginning, the Hyper-V module, a couple of ways we do deployments, and I want to talk about that first. There's a lot of people that think it's Windows installed first and then Hyper-V is installed. And actually what happens is when you install Hyper-V, and you can do, there's a couple of different ways to do that, but there's a free version of Hyper-V Server, and there's also a Server 2012 download where you turn on the role of Hyper-V. Whenever that role is turned on, it actually is injecting itself before the Windows OS boots, so that Windows OS becomes more of a management, a side management OS than anything. There's not something in between those two to cause harm. I know when I used to be in VMware, I would say I'm not really into running a Microsoft hypervisor because it runs on top of Windows, and Windows needs, you know, Patch Tuesday. Well, When Hyper-V and the new 2012 came out, it injects itself before the OS even boots. And the number of patches for Hyper-V is much less than if you were to be running a full version of Windows and all the different features and roles that are out there. So there was a lot of misconception there when Hyper-V 2012 first came onto the landscape. I want to make sure we cleared that piece up. And so let's talk about the ways that we can deploy it. So for Server 2012, if I'm installing from Server 2012, you go past your main screen and choose English and next, you can say, I want to install Server 2012 with a GUI or as a core installation. Now, I don't know how many of you out there are 2008 Hyper-V admins, but a lot of people installed in core mode in 2008 and then decided to abandon that because they couldn't really go back and forth very easily. Well, we're happy to tell you in Server 2012, I can now install Server with a GUI and then remove the GUI. Or we can run in a minimal GUI environment where you have Server Manager, but not anything else like Internet Explorer and those type of things can distract or cause harm from admins getting on downloading things they shouldn't be. So there's a couple different ways to handle managing the OS or the hypervisor. I can run it with a GUI, I can run it as a core mode, which is more like a command prompt, and I can also run it in a hybrid mode, which has the Server Manager and the command prompt, but not the other pieces. Also, there are many roles available that are included in Hyper-V, and that is like file and storage services. File and storage services comes with every version of Windows Server 2012. Why is that? Because of storage spaces. We'll talk a little bit about that later, but the ability to manage storage underneath the server is something that has to be there for every installation. So it is included in all of the different versions. Okay. Now, I talked about Server 2012. That's a standard Server 2012 DVD installation or ISO or network, and we'll talk through those pieces in a second. But now let's talk about Hyper-V Server. That's the free edition. A lot of people think the free edition means it's going to have less features than the full-blown edition, and that's just not true. The free edition of Hyper-V 2012 can do all the things that the paid-for edition of Hyper-V that role can do on Server 2012. I can cluster it. I can do live migrations. I can do those. I can export VMs. I can do snapshots, which we call checkpoints. All those different features come with that free edition of Hyper-V Server 2012. The only difference between Server 2012 and Hyper-V Server 2012, in my mind, is the licensing perspective for the guest OS. So If you own the licensing for the guest OSs already for virtualized environments, then maybe Hyper-V Server 2012 is your better platform to go with. If you're trying to do trying to manage a lot of new workloads, maybe Server 2012 Data Center is the way you should go. That comes with unlimited amount of guest OS VMs. So a couple of different ways to go there. But the Hyper-V Server 2012, just one thing to call out here, it is server core. And it does come with just a few roles available that that can be activated and features that can be activated, okay? So it is slimmed down on what you're able to deploy other than Hyper-V. But as far as the Hyper-V features, it does everything. And so there's three different ways of deploying, basically GUI and core, and then you have Server 2012 or Hyper-V 2012 GUI core, and then there's also that that minimal shell environment. Now, there's a couple of different ways to deploy. I can use a DVD or an ISO to deploy Hyper-V. I can deploy from a USB drive, or I can do a network deployment, like a Pixie boot for physical hosts going over the network. Okay, that's very, very comparable to what VMware does with their Pixie boot and such. From a network deployment perspective, Windows Deployment Services, that's the base. Okay, that comes with Server 2012. That allows you to do network deployments. You can use WIM, VHD, or VHDX images. It supports driver provisioning, doing unintended installs, UEFI. It's simple. It scales in the box. Okay. Now, to get even more configured or more complex in an environment, you may want to use the Microsoft Deployment Toolkit. That's the 2012 U1 edition. That gives you more granularity, allows you to do task sequences and applications and patches and that kind of thing. Makes things a little easier from that perspective. And then you've got System Center Configuration Manager, which can ride on top of those and do even more zero-touch environments. You could do groupings of virtual machines, groupings of hosts, and do different ways of applying patches to those particular groups. You can do patches based on users. There's all kinds of different ways of doing configuration management, and I just wanted to highlight those two. The biggest ones that we see in use when it comes to the enterprise level are System Center Virtual Machine Manager 2012 R2 and the Windows Deployment Services. However, that Microsoft Deployment Toolkit is very popular across even the SMB market. So how does that compare? Pretty much on par. The only thing is that Microsoft's kind of falls short on is the stateless side of things, where VMware has been doing that for a number of years. But just want to point out here, there's a couple of different ways of doing the stateful deployment. And one other thing that people overlook is, if you install Hyper-V, you have the iSCSI target server. That engine is built in. So I can offer my storage up via iSCSI to other hosts right there out of the box. So trying to get caught up here, these slides that you see, this VMware comparison slide, these slides were not made by marketing. They were not made by our, you know, what some people would call our VMware Ninja group that doesn't exist. These slides were made by our fellow evangelist, Keith Mayer. And they are in the white paper of aka.ms/compare-to-vSphere, and they are basically a just looking at the different things that each or that all of them can do, and whether or not Microsoft can do it, whether or not VMware can do it. That's all this is about. So I just wanted to pass that along, and that's the complete white paper if you'd like to download it. Now, physical and virtual scalability. In Server 2012 R2, we're doing 320 logical processors, 4 terabytes of physical memory, up to 1,024 virtual machines per host. Clusters can support up to 64 nodes and 8,000 virtual machines per cluster. Right? Virtual machine sizes. We can do 64 virtual processors and 1 terabyte of memory per VM, and NUMA is supported in guest. So I don't know how many folks are into the NUMA thing, but if you are doing a high I/O workloads, you're trying to tie the memory next to those processors directly to those particular virtual machines, you can use that the NUMA capabilities that that a lot of the modern architecture hardware have available to us. So that is there as well. From a VMware comparison, this was updated as of 5.5, so the latest VMworld numbers. If you look through, it's pretty much on par across the board. Maybe active number of virtual machines is a little different. Number of VMs per cluster is a little different. But other than that, they're pretty much apples to apples from a comparison perspective. Okay. Guest OS support. So from a server perspective, what OSs are supported? Okay. If you take a look at this, is the number of virtual CPUs that we can run inside a guest OS or a guest virtual machine. 64 virtual CPUs for Windows Server 2012 or R2. Linux workloads, you know, a couple of years back you can see Microsoft was one of the lead organizations that was adding to changing that Linux kernel. And the reason for that was to help us get ready for the new modern cloud OS. Microsoft took a step back and realized a couple of years ago that, you know, hey, this Linux thing really is something people are taking to. There are good reasons for running Linux. And we need to start embracing that. And if you've looked at Windows Azure, you'll see all those different types of Linux workloads ready to be run straight from the deployment wizard in Windows Azure. Why am I talking about Windows Azure? Because it runs all on top of Hyper-V. So Hyper-V had to be ready for the latest workloads, the biggest workloads, and not just the Microsoft workloads. Right? So I just want to highlight that. There's a TechNet article there if you want to go see more about the guest OS support. And from a client's perspective, we've got you can run 32 virtual CPUs in a Windows 8 or Windows 8.1 virtual machine. I'm not sure who would actually do that. If you've got some instances of that, I'd love to hear. But it does scale that high. And then, of course, the Linux side can scale to 64 as they share the same kernel. So just wanted to throw that out there. Notice that XP is out there with two CPUs, and that'll be until the end of life in April. So that is there as well.